20 to 30 and so on. So this is the intervals, and then the ratio. The most common one is you may find the odd ratio. So what is the odd ratio? Means suppose you have a NA2 particular class. So, and if you you try to identify some particular trait in that particular class, then you divide the trait by their class population, and then again you divide by your control one, then it's called odd ratio. So these are the ratios kind of things. But based on only those kind of information, it's very hard to tell what kind of test we need to done. Because even though your data is numerical, because most of the paper, if you see there is a numerical data is there, still you are using some non-parametric test, and sometimes you're using parametric test. So there is a question raises why the say similar kind of data. Suppose there is a numerical data, one time you are using some parametric test, sometime you are using some non-parametric set or some kind of test, or in a same kind of paper there is another kind of test. So that is actually based on what is the purpose of your data, how you data collected, and what is your property of your data. So all those things are actually influences your strategy to select the statistics which are you want to apply. So beyond of these data types, we will try to learn some conceptualization of data in our webinar. So first we have some idea means how our data is collected and what kind of distribution they have. So suppose there is a very simple example. You want to measure height of people in a town. So what you do, there is a 40,000 people. So there is a no other option except counting. So you simply go for head counting. How many people are there? And it is a counted data as well. And another thing is the height of each person. So, but height, you cannot count height. You have to measure it, because there is a several variables where you have seen the individual property, individual inherit property. So data means, even though it is a numerical data, the numerical data either a whole number or there is some continuous number. So when you count the data, those data are usually whole number, like 1, 2, 3, 30,000, 40,000, 50,000. But when you measure something, then it is not a whole number, but it is some point of decimal ranges, like 5 feet 8 inch is a height. It is not a 6, not a 5, because it is not countable. It is a measured value. So your numerical data has two kinds of property. Either it is a counter, either it is a measure. So based on those counted and measured tendency of your data, you actually decide what kind of states you want to perform and what is your objective. So next is we will see if we already talk about there is some counted data and measured data. So it is, I think, hope you understand what is the counted one, because you have physically go and count, means how many samples are there. And there is another case when you try to measure somehow, either it is by some centimeter tape, or you can weight something. So this kind of measurement. But there is some time when you sum all the pounds and divided by the height or number of samples, then you can get the average height of the population. So in the average height of population, you cannot say actually it is one is the counted data and another is the measured data. So this kind of data is you cannot put in directly into some counted data or either in measured data. So actually these are the mathematical derived data. So these are these are called the mathematical property of your data. And it includes your mean, it includes your variation, it includes your standard deviation, median, mode. So these kind of properties are actually the mathematical properties. So this is neither counted data, neither measured data, but this is the mathematically derived property. And the basic thing is that whatever kind of data you collected in respect of what kind of project you are doing, but it is very likely that you have all three kinds of data. Means it may be counted when you try to say I will collect 100 sample of each. So this is the counted data, and then you can say I will measure their weight. So this is the again a measured data. Then you define the mean of first group is something, and mean of another group is something. So this is the mathematical representation of your data. So whatever the study you do, you usually have the combination of all these three types of data. So we need to understand how our data is gathered, because until you know how your data is gathered, you cannot apply the appropriate strategy to deal. So that is why it is very important to see how your data collected and what is their property. So next we will see there is some counted data and measurement data. So we only need to see in which perspective we collected our data, what is our objective of the study, and that way we will decide our data should be what kind of measurement we need to do and how our data should be collected. So based on this objective in some perspective, we can broadly classify our data into two major categories. The first one is the parametric data, another one is the non-parametric data. So first we think in the name, as we suggested, parametric data means we can, parameters means some kind of values which can describe your data. So that means data, if I talked about some parametric data, so that simply means it must have some kind of parameter which is helpful to understand those data. And when I talked about non-parametric data, so that simply means there is no any particular value which can describe my data. The simplest example is the mean and standard deviation. So when you or a range, you can also say the range. So when you have value of range, minimum value, maximum value, mean value, and this kind of information you have, then you can calculate what kind of distributions you have. So these are the called the data, and based on these, they can be explained by some set of parameters. They are called the parametric data. And if there is not any particular set of parameter which describes your data, it is called a non-parametric data. Now let's see what are the examples. What is the difference between them? So let's start with the non-parametric data, which are counted or ranked. Means counted, as we already said, basically count something, that is called your parametric data. So either it is some population in a town, or you can see the growth of a bacteria in your medium. So this is the counted data, because you estimate how many colonies are there. So these are the counted data. The another one is the ranked data. So ranked data, we will see what are the examples of the counted and ranked data. So first we will see the counted data. As I already told you, the number of samples, simple head counts, means how many samples are there. So this is the very simplest form of counted data. Another thing is the ranked data. So in the ranked data, you have some abstract definition like short, medium, tall, heavy, light, tiny, and this kind of data where there is no clear demarcation between those words. Means if you say leaves of the plants are small, leaves of a plant are big, so you cannot figure it out. Means you cannot imagine if it is a small, then how much small it is, what is the definition of small, and if it is a big, then how much big it is, what is the definition of big. But you just It is a very subjective for that particular study. So this kind of data, you can say them the ranked data, because you can know the smaller, and there is a bigger one, there is a medium one. So the medium one lies somewhere in between the small and bigger one. So this kind of ranked data is a case of non-parametric data. So there is a, when you have some this kind of ranked data, you can say them as a category. Categories in the sense, petals, like something, if you talked about some plant, then few plant are short, few plant are tall. So this kind of data, you can say these are the categories, and these categories are represented by the ordinals. So this is the basic statistical term, ordinals, which actually comprises of the category, words, class, or your ranked data. So these are the ordinal data type, usually. So there is some common biological data we observed which have these non-parametric data. So these are number of samples, and suppose you have a groups like ranked data, you have some diseased, some non-diseased states, you have some ranked, like something, you have males in your population, females in your one population. There is some PCR products also. So these are the your non-parametric data, because you count your PCR products also, means how many replicates you have produces in your PCR. Just 1 minute. So let's start with the some parametric data. So parametric data, these data can be measured. So the non-parametric data, which you can count, or this is some kind of scaled ranked data, the parametric data which you can measure. So whatever you can measure, it is simply, it has a numerical behavior, means it is a numerical kind of data. So what are the some few common biological data we usually observe? So these are the, like, height. You can measure height, you can measure width. There is a blood glucose level. You usually read some paper where they counted, they have some blood level, hemoglobin level, your micro expression data, your gene expression data. It is also a measured data, because you mostly see they only, at last they talked about the expression matrix. So those expression matrix is a measured, means how much they expressed. So these are the measured data. So in a later stage, when you work with the microexpression data or gene expression data, so this kind of data, you are parametric data, because you measured those, you did not count. There is a no any abstract measured data. So those kind of data is called the parametric data. So is it you have parametric, measured something, and it is a sufficient condition to use so-called parametric test in your data? That we will see in upcoming slide, because even though you have numerical values in your samples or in a variables, it does not necessarily. So you can read them, and why this is, that we will discuss in upcoming slides. So usually where we talk about the parametric data, the biggest property has this for normal Gaussian distribution. You may have heard this information, means this information or this kind of line in most of your states book, your parametric data is for normal break, and this kind of thing. But what is the parametric data estimation? It must follow the normal Gaussian distribution. So first we try to see what is the normal follow Gaussian distribution. So this is the simple bell shaped curve. This is your data. Mu is your sample mean. Your sigma is your standard deviation. And this kind of bell-shaped curve, if you find, means whatever the data you have to plot those data. And those data, either you plot histogram, either you plot scatter plot, whatever plot you can do, you can see this kind of behavior trend in your data. And if you see something like this kind of trend in your data, you can say it is following the normal distribution. It is following the Gaussian distribution. So this is the biggest things. So whatever the data you ever see is a numerical form, first go and plot them and see whether there is a bell-shaped curve is there or not. If there is a bell-shaped curve is there, you are certain that whatever test, whatever your objective is there, but you will prefer the parametric test. And if you do not find this kind of bell-shaped in your numerical data, you are quite certain that we have to follow some non-parametric test. So this is the very basic things which you always keep in your mind. So there is another important thing that you may see, there is a standard deviation is usually smaller than your mean. And that is actually quite visible here, because more majority of your sample lies at the first standard deviation. So each standard deviation is usually smaller than your actual mean. In most of the papers, you can see the mean value is 10 and standard deviation is plus minus 2 or 2.5. So what it signifies? It signifies that your sample mean is 10 and the standard deviation is 2.5. Means most of your samples are lies between 7.5 to 12.5. Means your 66% samples are lies between this range. So in such cases, you can know whether your data is normally distributed or some kind of normal distribution is there or not. Why I am quoting this point here? Because in most of data you can see, because this is, if you do not want to plot your data, you simply calculate mean and standard deviation. And if you see your standard deviation is quite higher, means approx near to your mean or sometime higher than your mean, then you can see there is no normal distribution. Your data is not following the normal distribution. It is whatever the distribution it has, but you are quite certain that these data, if your standard deviation is equal to your mean or greater than your mean, this is your first test, first insight about your data is that your data is, even though it's numerical nature, it is not following the normal distribution. So whatever the states you will apply, it should not be parametric, but is the non-parametric. You have to apply the non-parametric test. So next, we will see what is the non-parametric data. As we talk about, there is a numerical values, but in a non-parametric data, you have categories, ordinals, and numerical, both kind of data. So when it is a ordinal, then you can simply plot bar graph, and you know you have to use your data as a non-parametric test. But it also depends on another data. Means when you talk about some class and control kind of things, you must know what kind of distribution your actual variable follows. So where there you have to decide, even though you have a categories, what kind of distribution they are following. So now, if a non-parametric data, the simplest thing is it does not follow the Gaussian distribution, and you cannot identify any sign of Gaussian distribution. There is no bell-shaped curve. Actually, you may not find any kind of clear distribution of your data. Means, and this may be due to either it is a completely random or either it is a mixture of one or more distribution. So in this kind of situation, your simple distribution cannot explain your data very well. So in such case, you cannot identify the distribution of data, because in parametric you can clearly see there is a normal distribution, but in a non-parametric you do not find some kind of any kind of this distribution. So that's why most of time it is also called distribution free data, because in most of time you do not know what kind of distribution they follow. So that's why we also call them distribution free data. So these are the few examples are there like as you can see, the most left side data, you can see there is an input X and its range is -2 to +2, and then output is a Y. You can see there is a no clear trend in this data. Suppose you can say this is the trend of age in your sample. So it is quite possible because you are using it as an indexed value, means your sample wise, and you are putting the your samples in a that direction. And in your sample, there is a male and female, both are there. So in such case, it is, does not seem to follow any particular distribution. So this is the one example of your distribution data. The right one example is when you have the categorical data, ordinal data. So as you can see, there is a very first example is the Posius and Central Asia data, and you have the data of a region on the base of literacy data, and you can see there is a no clear trend in your data based on this graph. And another thing is that they have they are the category, they are a ranked data, so you cannot see any clear distribution here. So this kind of data is your non-parametric data. So what are the key points? So first points is you have to identify or you have to examine how your data is collected and what property it has. The another thing is that you have to plot your data. If you are unable to plot data, at least calculate its mean and standard deviation. It will tell you your data is, there is a, some sign of normally distribution or not. So this is very important thing. So like if you talk about some example, your blood glucose, gene expression usually do not follow normal distribution, despite of you can measure them. And because it is very non-fact, even your age is also one of them. Because if you try to conduct some study, like you want to check some effect of some vaccine in your population, then you select some samples which are lies between the age of 20 to 60, and you make them categories wise, means like 20 to 30 age group, 30 to 40 age group, 40 to 50, and 50 to 60, and so on. So when you divide your age data in a categories, then it it's a normal distribution kind of property is lost. So in such kind of data, you have to see means what kind of modification you are doing with your raw data and what effect it has. And when you see all those, you have and when you have idea of what kind of information, what kind of transformation you are doing, then you can easily infer what you need to do as a statistician. So these are the very few examples, means very key points which you must aware of, and you always have to very cautious when you ever try to perform this kind of data, perform this kind of analysis, or whenever you go for some sample collection. So this is the few, and in respective of what kind of study you are going to do, these things are not going to change. This is the most fundamental thing, how you collected your data and what kind of transformation you are doing, because the raw property of data never changes. If you selected the samples itself will always be a non-parametric, because you have already counted your data. So it is your counted data, it is a non-parametric data. When you measure height, when you measure weight, so this is the numerical data, but based on that distribution, then you will decide it is your actually your parametric data, or you have to go for something else. So these are the key points. What it comes when you start collecting your data. So this time, if you aware at that time when you collecting your data, you are well aware, then you can easily identify what kind of data you need to go for, and what kind of problem you are addressing, and what kind of topics are applicable in that kind of data. Even though you read the paper and you apply those kind of same states in your data, but what if you have some another kind of data, then you have to decide, because if there is a reference in a paper and you are comparing age and sex and something like that, then it is easy because you can refer the same paper. But if you are collecting your own data and you are working on your own problem, then you must have to clarify what property your data inherits. So these are the important features. So what are the problems we see in scientific literature in a broader sense? So the first thing is that effect of one or more variable on your data. So like something you may have seen many papers which are usually related with the stress. So in a stress condition, suppose you supply some nutrients into plants in a stress condition, what is its effect in its growth? So this kind of information you usually see, there is some kind of papers are there. When you see the effect of stress of micronutrients on a plant or an animal, so this kind of data when you do, so this is the broadly those kind of analyses that comes under the effect of, identify the effect of one variable. Variable here is that micronutrient. Suppose it may be iron, it may be magnesium, it may be sodium, or whatever micronutrients are there. And if it is found in a stress condition, or salt, any kind of salt, it is found in a stress condition, what is its effect on an overall plant growth? So this kind of analysis, when you try to perform, so this is also, you can find many kind of problems which are similar to these. When you try to see the effect of any one variable on your overall data. So there is no any class or control data, but still you have two population where one population is under stress and one population is not under stress. Or there may be after and before kind of situation when the same population you treat with some stress environment and then you can go with some normal environment. So in this kind of data you usually see in your paper. So these are the very broad terms. Most of the you see the nature of the problem is identifying the effect of one variable. So this is the broader sense of those kind of problems. Another kind of problem is see the differentiate groups, and those differentiate groups, like mostly you can see the case control kind of study. So this case and control kind of study have very large number of prospectives, really large number of views where you are using this case and control kind of study. The most common thing is the identifying some effect of drug. So when you try to develop some drug and you have some cases and controls, suppose you are developing some drug for a diabetic patient, then in such cases you have some cases which are actually diabetic group, and then the controls, healthy controls, and then you give your medicine to them, and then you can see if any there is any difference is there or not. Or you try to see what is the effect of high blood pressure in a normal population or in general population. So this kind of study, you have some cases which have the high blood pressure, and there is a few control samples which do not have such a disease, and you can compare their blood pressures over time in a different situation. These are the case control study where you try to infer if there is a particular trait is associated with some particular phenomena of your data or phenomena of your population or not. So these are the major problem we usually see. So this is the one of the broader sense when you try to identify some influential trait in your case and control group. So this is the problem you usually see in your scientific literature. So what kind of those data is on the basis of single variable? So in a single variable, you assume that single variable is responsible for the change. So whenever you have ever seen and ever learn about the states, you see there is some t test, some chi-square test, some ANOVA test are there, but you always wondering why and when these states are used. So those t test or chi-square test are univariate test when you try to see the effect of one variable in your population. So usually this is the based on the one variable. So in that sense, you usually go for the t-test or chi-square test. Another one is the on the basis of two or more variable. So in such scenario, you go for the ANOVA, MANOVA, or regression model. So and in a regression model is a more beneficial. Actually, we will talk about later in some upcoming lecture series. But there is a, let me explain you here, if we already, I already talked about this. There is a slightly difference between ANOVA and regression model, because in ANOVA you see the effect of two or more variables on your groups, but you cannot capture their interrelation, means their interaction term. Those interaction terms easily captured in the regression model, means you can see, means any particular two variables come interact and have though, and there is any some effect of these interactions on individual or some group of people or not. So this kind of study is usually done by the regression model. The easiest example is the cancer research. When you ever try to read some cancer research problem, they talked about the mutations. And when they talked about the mutations, they usually perform the logistic regression, because they try to identify if there is a one mutation invokes, it promotes the another mutations, and by those provoking effect of those both mutations, the entire gene is changed, entire product is changed, and thus these kind of changes result in some different kind of protein which usually malfunction. So this kind of analysis is usually done in a cancer research, when you have you usually identify what kind of mutations are associated with your diseased state. So in
Deepak,
such
we cases, have a question here from Rishikesh also. He's asking that what kind of data is DNA sequencing data, and is it parametric or non-parametric?
Yeah, actually DNA sequencing data, first thing, whenever your data is sequenced, especially in case of suppose transcriptomics, so those are the actually quantics. So when your quantics are you received, this is the your raw data. You cannot say this is the your counted data or your measured data, because it is the combination. Because when you align with your reference genome, you see how many quantics are aligned on the reference genome. So in that time you see counts, but when you go, you create your expression profile, you see measurement, means there what is the difference. So actually this is the mixed kind of data. At what stage you are analyzing your data is depends what kind of problem you are looking for. When you are talking about the quantic and its alignment to reference, you go for the count, because you see how many quantics are aligned. So this is the quality check, and this quality check it mainly depend upon how many quantics are aligned. So this is the count data, but when you create your expression matrix, it is the measurement of your data.
And so when we are talking about variations, then we do as you talked about the cancer research analysis.
Yes, when you talk about the variation, it is again the count data. Means suppose there is a variation, you say there is a mutation in a कैंसर ग्रुप, बट देर इज अ नो म्यूटेशन इन अ नॉन कैंसर, मीन्स योर नॉर्मल मैच्ड नॉर्मल कंडीशन, तो यू एक्चुअली काउंट, बिकॉज इफ देर इज अ म्यूटेशन यू नो देर इज अ फोर न्यूक्लियोटाइड्स आर देयर ATGC इन अ नॉर्मल पॉपुलेशन. You see, there is a A. Most of time A is appears, but here it is a T appears. So you count. Means there is a, suppose 30% cases have T, and rest condition has A. So here you count. So this is the count data. When you try to check the difference, and that's why whenever in a cancer research you compare the mutations, you go for the chi-square test, because you categorize your A and T is a count data there. So you categorized your data, means A is a category, T is a category, G is a C category, but in a one group there is a two category and another group there is a one category. So of course there is a huge difference. So in a, that sense your data is your count data, means, and you go for the some non-parametric test, and sometimes you go for the chi-square test also. Means based on both are applicable.
Please write
I hope
your
that you
queries.
Understand me.
Yeah, please write your queries in your in the chat box. I don't see the queries for queries now. Please write down your queries if you have any. We'll take the other queries at the end of the session now. Thank you.
So here is the some examples we actually talked about, which we use, which you usually see in a scientific literatures, where you see the effect of drug and vaccine. So this is based on your one variable, means either you are giving the drug, say yes, and if you are not giving the drug, say no. Or if you try to see what dose, so in case of dose, you have different kind of measures. Suppose you get giving 500 mg, you have giving 200 mg or 400 mg. So in such case your data properties changes. One is the category, another is the numerical, and in a numerical it is a ranked one. So in such cases you go for the non-parametric test. But suppose if you have only yes and no, you are giving your data, your patient vaccine or not, then you can simply go for the parametric test, which is called a chi-square test. Another example is the blood glucose difference between diabetic non-diabetic patient, gene expression in a diseased and non-diseased condition, micronutrient consumption or gene expression in stress and non-stress condition. So usually based on your interest, when you go for the some plant science, or you can go for some animal science, these are the few major problems you usually see. Means this is not the major problem literally, but you can see the overall idea of your research, because you try to answer those kind of research. What is the effect of one variable in your population? This is your fundamental question, irrespective of what kind of field you are working on, either it is a plant, either it is an animal or something else, whatever. But your basic question is there a difference in a group, or is there a effect of one variable in a group? So this is the most fundamental question, and based on what kind of data property you have, you decide what kind of test you have to perform. So this kind of test comes under the inferential statistics. In the inferential statistics, you can take the data from the sample and make inferences. Inferences in the sense you can propose some hypothesis, means there is some difference or no, and then you try evaluate your data on the basis of several statistical methods. And then you can say whether your hypothesis is accepted or not accepted. So what kind of data you usually have? So first is the when you want to see the difference in population. But here we are saying that the population is the independent population and the single population, and you want to check the before and after condition. The very very easy example is we want to check the effect of exercise on a human health. So you have some volunteers who actually do not regularly do exercise. You measure their various metabolic activities. You measure their various blood and lipid level profiling, and then you go for some schedule for the exercise. And after 1 or 2 months, for the same population, the same individual, you measure all the data which you already measured before the you apply the procedures, and then you have the another set of data and you are comparing those data. So what is the difference here? What is the key point here? Key point is here, these are the same population, the same individual. The only condition is the before and after condition. Means the same individual, what is the effect before your treatment and what is the effect after your treatment. Whatever the exposure you are giving, whatever the method you are applying is called the treatment. So those in such cases, when you see there is a single population, single samples, but first you do not have any treatment and later you give some treatment and then measure some kind of data. So those kind of data is called the paired kind of data. Paired, why paired? Because it is the same individual, but before and after condition. So when you say this is the before and after condition, so that simply means it's a paired data. And if it is follow the parametric test, you should go for the paired test and something like that. There is another alternative of a non-parametric test. It is a called Wilcox-Fox-Rank-Sum test or Mann-Whitney test. So ideally both work the same. But what is the key point to notice? You have how to decide your data is paired. There is a single population. But before and after treatment, then it is a paired. So of course, if there is a paired sample, then there is some unpaired sample also. So in unpaired samples, you talk about the two populations. So usually most of your case and control kind of study are usually unpaired kind of test. Means suppose you are trying to see what is the gene expression level of a diabetic patient and what is the gene expression level of a normal person. So of course you have different sets of individuals. The one set, your cases are those who have diabetes and your controls are those who does not have diabetes. So in such cases, your individuals are different. Your individuals, your data comes from the different population. So these are the unpaired tests. And again, if your data is following those Gaussian kind of distribution, your measurement follow the Gaussian kind of distribution, you go for the parametric test. Means t-test or chi-square test, whatever is there. And if it does not follow your Gaussian distribution or you cannot find any distribution at all, you can go for the non-parametric test. Okay, so it is a very simple thing. You just keep it all those things into your mind, then you can easily understand your problem. You can easily identify what kind of property your data has and what kind of test you need to done, and what is and the most important thing, what the hypothesis you need to build. Means what is your objective of your study, and on the basis of your study you collect your data, see their properties and decide what kind of tests you need to apply. Now if you see, I talked about the parametric test, and then I can see I have told you there is some set of parameters like mean and standard deviation, which is, if you, I talked about the Bell shape, of course, if you see the formula of the Gaussian distribution, it mainly involves the variance in the form of standard deviation and the mean value. So these two parameters of the, you can, if you have these two parameters, you can identify your Gaussian distribution. Similarly, there is another kind of distribution also, but our parametric test is applicable to normal distribution only. So in such case, when you have some parameters which are able to describe your data, you can go for your parametric test again. And mostly in those parametric tests, you compare the mean and median value. Mean and median, what is the why we should go for mean and median? Because if you see the bell curve, you can simply see the majority of the sample is gathered around the mean. So if your means of two population are on a different scale, then you can see the majority of your samples are gathered on a different data points, different mean values on a different location. If you talk about the axis, it is located on a different axis, different locations on a axis. So in such case, you usually try to check if there is a difference in a mean or not. Whatever kind of test you do, whether if you can do t-test or chi-square test or your Mann-Whitney test. If your data is a numerical, you usually check whether your mean are significantly different or not. Because if the mean are significantly different, your population should be different. The most common example is that our height, human height. You have learned somewhere, human height is a normal distribution. Majority of people lies between 5'8", mean is 5 feet 8 inch, and the majority of people are between 5.5 to 6.2. So this is the normally distribution data. But suppose you are also try to check the height in a penguin. So in penguin also you find the normal distribution curve, but the average height mean value should be very, very less there. Suppose it is 2 feet. So based on those values, we can see these two populations are different. So even though they following the normal distribution, if we check, we compare their mean value, we can clearly identify these data comes from the different population. These data come from the human. These data comes from penguin. So this is the basic idea about the any statistical test you are applying. On a larger scale, when you talked about one or more variable, then you compare their variance, like ANOVA and MANOVA. But we will talk about them in some upcoming session. So in most of cases means in every state's book, or your first hypothesis, the null hypothesis, is always be there is a no difference. It must contain the word there is a no difference, whether you are talk about some case and control kind of thing, or whether you talk about some before and after condition. Like, say, for example, in a before and after condition, you are talking about effect of exercise on a human health. So your null hypothesis is always be there is a no difference of, and there is a no effect of exercise on a human health. So this is your null hypothesis, and your own study is aimed to prove the null hypothesis wrong. Means you do not need to modify your data, but you always assume there is a no difference in a group due to any treatment. So this is the basic statement of any null hypothesis. Whatever field you are choosing, the overall in sense of that null hypothesis is that there is a no difference on the basis of variable or on the basis of another treatment. So there is a no effect of treatment on population. If you see something some similar like of statement in any somewhere else, you can say that there is your null hypothesis. So what is your and you want to reject those null hypothesis. So what is the effect means? And then there is a two possibilities. If you say there is a no effect or the both population are same, then there is a two scenario are there. Either your population is smaller or have a lesser than the another population, or either your population of interest has a greater or larger value than the other population. So when you try to answer this kind of question, means your case has a, if your question is your case has a higher value of insulin or glucagon than the controls, then it is called one cell test, because you are testing your hypothesis only in one direction. But if you say your alternate hypothesis there is a clear difference between two populations, then it is a two way. It considers both the lower and lower or smaller scenario and greater and larger scenario. In either way, it tests whether your two populations, your case and controls are different. At either end, means either your case are higher or your case are lower. In both situation, when you perform your test, then it is called two-tailed test, because you are checking the extreme condition in both ways. But if you want to try, means if, and of course it is depends on what kind of problem you are dealing with. If your problem is to check there is a low cholesterol level in a healthy human, and then the obese person, then of course it is a one cell test. You design your test similarly like that. You are interested to see whether your cases has high cholesterol level than the control or not. And so in such case, you go for the one cell test. So this is the some basic things which you usually see in your papers. So whenever you try to read such paper and you see we perform one cell test, it actually explicitly defined when your objective is something like that. But if you only want to test whether your population are different or not, then you can simply go for the two-tailed test. Most of the paper you will see is two-tailed test, means they only consider there is a difference or not. If there is a difference, then difference is significantly different or not. That is the only thing which you may see in most of the paper. And how to define there is a difference, and that difference is significant or not. So based on the p-value. So p-value, right now you just need to know that the smaller the p-value, the greater is the significance. So in most of the paper you see the significance value p is 0.05. So and your confidence interval is 95%. So that in a very raw form, you may assume out of your 100 observation, your 5 observation may be false. So this is the overall idea of the significance value. Means you are 95% sure that your data is right, your inference is right. So in most of cases, this p-value helps you to identify, to test your result are significantly different or no. Now suppose there is a one example here. You can see there is a case and control kind of study, means as we already see case and control kind of study, and there is a similar number of patients are here, and you can see there is a p-value column is here, and later stage you have averaging the values of AK area in the sense here. What they did in this particular paper, they compared the burnt area in a cases and controls. So now, as you can see, the average value 0.60 and in a cases, and standard deviation is 1.18, and the another is the 0.67 and 0.68. In later stage, you can see the average value 0.10 plus minus 0.13 and 1.10, 0.92. Here you can see your mean value is near to your standard. Your standard value, standard error value, standard deviation is quite near to your, and sometimes higher than your mean value. And you are calculating the p-value. So what kind of tests you need to apply? So as you can see, they perform the student t-test. Why? Because it is following somewhere they found it is following the normal distributions. But here, as you can see, the first value in a t0, the zero, it is the value whatever you find is zero greater than 0.05, so it is a non-significant difference. But in another, we will found there is a significant difference, 0.01. So in this stage, your data, you can see here is your data is there. You find the mean and value. You plot your data and then you find, and then you apply student t-test. But is it appropriate to use student t-test here? Statistically, no. You should not apply student t-test here. But you should apply some non-parametric test, because if you see your mean and standard deviation, it is there is a no sign that it will following the normal distribution. So in such cases, even though they are applying the student t-test, the result is not different. Why? Because in either you use a parametric test or non-parametric test, whether their values may different, but they indicating the direction. Actually, they indicating the direction means there is a significant difference or not. So whether you use the student t-test, they using the student t-test and they get there is a significant difference. Even they if they had you a non-parametric test, it also shows the say similar kind of trend. But in a states view, whatever they applied is not appropriate for this kind of study, because there is a no sign of normal distribution. And if there is a no sign of normal distribution, you should not apply the parametric test, which is t-test here. Another example here is the application of drugs. So you can see there is a various categories are there, and you can see there is some p-values are also there, and there is an absolute change also given here. And as you can see, the mean value and the standard deviation, about the absolute change, you can see your standard deviation is almost equivalent to your mean value. And as we already discussed, in such situations, the non-parametric tests are most appropriate. And what are the non-parametric tests? Either it is a Mann-Whitney or the Wilcox rank sum method. So in such paper, they use Wilcox signed rank test, which is the appropriate for this kind of scenario, because your data is not following the normal distribution. And this is your categories data. This is your data are categorical, because you have a different kind of drugs and you are seeing the effect of those drugs in your case and control types of data. Means the case and controls in the sense here, this is the before and after situation. One is the baselines, means before applying the drug, and this is the after 6 months. So after 6 months, you can see there is a difference. There is some trend here. It is a decline trend. So after applying those drugs, their difference means whatever their effect and whatever the purpose they are solving, they are actually fulfilling those purpose. Means all those thing drugs are actually useful in such scenario, because they lowering the baseline value. So in such case, we applied the Wilkinson signed rank test. It's a non-parametric test, and it is very useful test for this kind of situations. There is another such examples here. You may also see there is a various values are here. As you can see, there is a sex, race, and smoker, non-smoker. Sex, there is always a categorical variable, male and female is there. race is there, white or black, smoker, either they smoke, either they don't smoke. All the data are ordinal in nature, categories in nature. And when you try to answer your data categories wise, you go for the chi-square test. So here you can see there is a chi-square test is applied, because in category, when you have category, you have a ranked data, you go for the chi-square test. And in such case, you go for the p-values. So here you can see there is a, your attempers, your non-attempers, and you can differentiate again, because again they are following some kind of normal distribution. So here we will use chi-squared test, and this way we can simply differentiate whether two populations in this particular paper, suicide attempts versus non-suicide attempts, there is a significant difference or not. And you can see in most of times there is a no significant difference except 1 and 2, 3 places. So these are the data you usually see in most of your study literatures, and based on the your properties you can decide what kind of data you have seen. So this is the quick summary. So when you have parametric data and you have unpaired group like we already said, this is the case control of study. Your data, if your data following the Gaussian distribution, normal distribution, you can go for the unpaired t-test. But if it does not follow the normal distribution, it's equivalent to the Mann-Whitney test. Similarly, if your data is a paired, then you can go for the paired t-test. And if your data again is not following the Gaussian distribution, you go for the Wilcoxon sum test. Similarly, the Pearson correlation, when you compare any two variables and their correlation, either they are increasing simultaneously or decreasing simultaneously, those kind of behavior you can check via Pearson correlation. In a Pearson correlation, generally the correlation value is -1 to 1. -1 means that is a negative correlation. Negative correlation means one variable is increasing, another variable is decreasing. And the positive correlation means there is a both going in a similar direction. Either they increase, either they decreasing. The value near to zero is shows they are actually independent. There is a no as such association between them. So again, this correlation is counted on the numerical values, and if those numerical data follow the normal distribution, you go for the Pearson correlation. And if it does not follow the normal distribution, you go for the Spearman correlation or Kendall correlation. Kendall correlation is especially more useful when you have interval data, means you want to check the difference in a different age group, like 10 to 20 years, 20 to 30 years. And such kind of data, when you are dealing with, you go for the Kendall correlation data. The chi-square test, I already tell, it is mainly deal with the categorical data, ordinal data, means you have cases, and then just some, like suppose you are cases is the cancer, one variable is the smoking. The smoking has only two cases, either it is smoke, either it is non-smoking. So in such cases, your data means your overall data has a parametric nature, means any particular, either the age group or their response, you can plot them as a binomial distribution, as a normal distribution. Then you can apply the chi-square test. If you cannot plot as a Gaussian distribution, you can go for the Crusall-Wallis test or feature test. The feature test is actually more useful when you have small number of samples. So these are the few key points which you should remind. The another key point is that in for a parametric data, you actually talk about your data distribution, and to identify correct distribution of your data, you have sufficient number of samples. So most of the when you ever try to solve some question in your statistics exam, they say there is a different formulas when your sample is less than 30 or greater than 30. So these are some few limitations for the parametric test. Means if you want to identify the correct distribution of your data, you have very large samples. But if you have a very small sample, even though you have the normal distribution, suppose height, and you know, because human height is a normally distributed, but you have very few number of samples, you can apply a non-parametric test also, because number of samples are very small. However, in your most of the paper, when you see, you always try to go statistically correct, but your background information is also helpful. So you have to maintain the balance about those inference. But if you first you have to see if your data is following the distribution, satisfy all the assumptions of a parametric data, then you without any doubt you should use the parametric test. Like as we say, if your data is numerical, go for the t-test. If your data is categorical, go for chi-square test. You want to check the relation between any two variables, go for the correlation values. And similarly, if you want to go to check whether there is some difference before and after conditions, so in such situation also you can go for the parametric or non-parametric test based on their distribution. So the key points are how your data collected and what kind of distribution is following. If it is not following the normal distribution, you should always choose the non-parametric test in your paper. And most of the paper you will see, you mostly find the non-parametric tests are usually used. So first thing, how you can do all those kind of tests. So in this particular webinar, I did not go for their mathematical explanation and some kind of tutorial. But actually, I have given you some links. But if you want to perform those kind of data, you can. There is some functionality in Excel. There is a few web server also available, and I will tell you. There is a few web server where I give you some live demonstration. Because if I'm assuming if you are not familiar with Excel or any kind of statistical package, you can simply use. You have your data in a simple CSV format or Excel file, you can simply copy those data into those web servers and they will give you your idea about whether your populations are different or not. So these are two samples are there, the web servers are there. I will let me do one thing for you. Okay. Let's start with this one. Oh, okay. So here you can calculate the t-test. As you can see, there is a different options are here. And what kind of unpaired test we already talked about. The unpaired test when your data has a case and control kind of nature. And there is a paired test when you have the data something like that. Now let me check them. I do not want to do much thing, but so that's why I am simply providing these mean, standard deviation and number of samples. So if, as I already test, there is only one difference in an unpaired and paired test. In an unpaired test, your population, your samples come from the two different populations. And when you used paired t-test, your samples are the similar one. So these are the your data are here. So as you can see, there is a many data are here. Now let me give you here. Suppose I'm selecting 50, and this is the 35 standard deviation 2. Here is a 2.4. number of samples 200. Here it is a 300. And now you can go for the unpaired t-test. And now you will see, as you can see, the p-value is less than 0.01. So there is a significant difference because we compare their mean. And one's mean is 50, the another mean was 35. So of course there is a clear difference among them, and those differences are actually quite significant. And you can see here there is a 95% confidence interval also given, means you this 95% confidence intervals is there, means there is a difference between your groups, like one is the 50, one is the 35, so that means the difference is 15. And as you can see, there is a difference is 15, and you can your most of the measures, your most of the measures differences are lies between 40.5 to 15.40. means there is a very narrow window because standard deviation is very low in our data. I provided only 2 and 2.5, so that's why this window is very small. Your most majority of sample, at least 66% samples, are just within these two values. So this is very high confidence data, and that's why it is very significant as well. Now let's see. Similarly, the Mann-Whitney test is also there, and you can go for the Pearson correlation as well. Now let me show you one more example. As we can see, the Mann-Whitney test is only for the non-parametric data. So here you can say there is already number of givens. Now let me quickly do few things like P and P 4, 5, 5, 6, 5, 5, 3, 7, 9, 7. I think this is the sufficient one. And now let 34, 33, 31, 6, 5, 6, 7, 4, 5, 3. And these are two groups, whatever the, suppose these are the age groups. And now the significance level is, I set to 0.05 and 2 tel. I want to check whether it is significantly different or not. So now you can say the U value is already is there, and your P value is significant because it is 0.05. And how I calculated is that if you see the numbers, most of numbers here are centered around 30, even though it is not following the normal distribution. And here you can see there is a large difference. The number are ranging from 23 to 89, but there is no any clear difference. Of course, this is also not following the normal distribution of data is different. This is somewhere between 30s and it may be somewhere between 50s. So that's why both populations are significantly different. And this is your U value and Z score. And here you can simply see your two populations are quite different in your given criteria. So this is the one example. And if you are very familiar with R packages or Python, there is a several packages are also available there. And this way you can start your collecting your data, or you can start to work on your data. And the main important thing is that you have to understand how your data is collected. You have to understand how your data is collected and what property it inherits. So this way, when you keep those mind, those small points in your mind, you won't feel distracted in your study, and you can easily understand this particular method, this particular test is applied. If applied, then why it is applied. So the answer of why is lies how you see your data, how you collected your data, how you checked your properties of your data. So this is the very first step in your data analysis of your data. And it is a very, you do not need to think much, or you do not need to learn more. You just need to take care of only few things. The first thing is your data. What kind of data you had? What kind? Suppose it is a numerical data, then simply see whether it is normally distributed or not. And if it is normally distributed, go for the parametric test. Not normally distributed, go for the non-parametric test. Similarly, if your data is categorical wise, then you can simply see the overall distribution of your data. Again, the similar thing. If it is a normally distributed, go for the parametric test like chi-square test. If it is a non-normal distribution, then go for the non-parametric test like Mann-Whitney kind of test. So this is very, very simple things. You just need to keep track of what kind of data you have and what kind of distribution it follows. You do not need to completely derive your distributions also.
And we have got this questions, is the few basic. So Deepak, we have got the questions on the basis of this only. So Roshan is asking so actually you have already answered his question. So he has asked what the type of test we choose depend only on the type of raw data available. So you just answered his question.
Sorry, what is the question?
So type of test we choose depend only on the type of raw data available. Roshan is asking that.
Yes, actually first your data is raw. If you are using your data in a raw form, then, but if you transform your data, suppose the age one, the age is a, usually age is not normally distributed, because when you categorize your data, means you make interval of your data, you simply you simply distribute your data in a various age categories like 10 to 20 years, 20 to 30 years. But the number of people's, number of individuals in each categories get different. So the entire property become different. So this is the things which you should keep in your mind. Because if you make some transformation of your raw data, your strategy is changed accordingly. Suppose if you collected the age information of your data, or height information, the most trivial example is the height. Height is a normally distributed variable, but if you categorize your data 4 to 5, 5 to 5.5, 5.5 to 6, 6.6 to 6.5, then of course you get different kind of bars based on their bin value. And in such case, person, it lost its property of being normal distributed. Because it is quite possible that you have a high number of values in a 4.5 height and a low number of values and 6.5 height. So in such scenario, you categorize your data, and in such scenario, you should go for the non-parametric test. Even it is in a raw form, it is a normally distributed. It is measured, normally distributed, but now you transform your data in an interval. So in such situation, if you are comparing any two in age interval group, you have to go for the non-parametric test.
And then
I think it is understandable now.
Yeah, I think so. Yes. And so we have another question from Rohit. He's asking that if you treat different tissue sample data as different population, when all the samples were collected from... Do you treat different tissue sample data as different population when all the samples were collected from the same individual? So he's asking this, and so he's also mentioning that primary tissue data where there is not control or case situation. So I'm not also pretty much sure. If Rohit, are you here?
Can you Yes, you can
Yes,
reclaim
ma'am.
it.
So my question was, like, if from an individual I am taking different tissue data. So I took adipose tissue, I took liver, and then I took skin tissue, and then I would like to just compare, like, did the RNA-seq analysis. I have gene counts, and I just wish to see whether certain set of genes are elevated in skin, they are not as much elevated in liver or adipose. So if I have that kind of data where I don't have any control case situation per se, so
No. Of course. Yeah, I can understand your question. Actually, this is not a case control data, but you are comparing groups, two or
yes.
more groups. Like you are comparing your adipose tissue with suppose your brain cells for some particular gene expression data. Okay. So in such cases, you simply check whether your particular gene is expression is higher than the other or not.
So wouldn't it be appropriate, like, for all the, like for one sample, we have gene counts for all the genes that are present in that sample. So we plot a histogram distribution for every sample and then see if the gene expression follows the normal distribution and then decide.
No, you cannot do those things because the first thing about data is the homogeneity. Because your brain cells are different than your adipose tissue, because its local environment is different, its requirement, its functioning is different. So actually, even though you are telling about you are taking the samples from the same individual, but you are talking about that same individual is actually your population now, and your samples are those cells. Okay, so from the same samples you are from the same population you are taking different samples now. You can understand what I am saying?
Yes, sir, I got
Yeah,
it.
yeah. So that way, when you took the different samples from the same population, and the same population is here is the one individual. Okay, because it has a vast number of cells, so population is here is cells. So you took some kind of cells there, and some kinds of brain cells, some kind of adipose tissue cell, and now you are trying to comparing the gene expression data. So the thing is that even though they are come from the same population, they have the different local environments. And in such case, when you try to differentiate them, you have to compare them on the basis of counts or number of expressions. Means whether if you try to compare their counts, then you have to see how many counts are there. In such cases, when you try to say the counts, you simply use the non-parametric test. But if you are talking about the gene expression values, then you have measured such values. And when you have such measured values, you have multiple samples, then you have to plot those data and see what kind of distribution they are following. If they are following the normal distribution, you can simply compare your data using parametric tests like t-test. But those biological samples also do not follow the normal distribution. That I already told you, the gene expression microarray data, they do not follow the normal distribution. So in such cases, you usually go for the chi-square test if you are comparing some expression yes and no form, or either go for the some non-parametric test. So this is the overall idea behind the tissue from the same individual.
Thank
Thank you,
you,
sir.
Deepak, for this answer. I
Got it.
hope Rohit is now satisfied. If you have any queries, just write them in the chat box.
Is there any
So,
other question?
no, these were the only questions. So, I hope Deepak, you are almost done with the presentation because we are, it's almost 5:40
If you
now.
have any question, please ask here.
Yeah, you can write down in the chat box. We can.
Actually, the purpose of this entire webinar is to give you
Exactly.
a brief idea. You can, if you are not very much familiar with any packages, there is a, I just inform you that there is a various web server are available. So if you have collected your data, you can simply use those web server as well. But the important idea is that we are not here to understand what is the mathematics behind those tests, but we are interested to see in which scenario what kind of test we need to perform.
Yeah, yes,
So I
that
hope
is clear.
this yes.
So
So I hope you understand this some very basic and fundamental things.
it
And
was
if you
very
have
insightful,
any
Deepak. Yeah.
problem,
So if anybody has any
yes.
question, please write that down here, or you can directly ask with from Dr. Deepak. So Deepak, are you done with your presentation, or is there some anything left?
Hello.
No. Yeah, it is done. It's done. Hello.
So
Yeah. Yes.
may I know who's this?
I think Sanjay.
Yeah, Sanjay, please.
Sanjay.
हाँ सर, हाँ सर, मैं ये पूछना चाहता हूँ, अगर मैं किसी यूनिक जीन को एक्सप्रेशन पढ़ना चाहता हूँ फ्रॉम डिफरेंट टिश्यू ऑफ सेम इंडिविजुअल, तो कैन आई डू पैरामेट्रिक टेस्ट ऑफ दैट जीन?
नहीं, वो उसके एक्चुअली जो आपके जीन एक्सप्रेशन की जो वैल्यू आएगी, व्हाट एवर द जीन एक्सप्रेशन वैल्यू यू हैव, फर्स्ट यू वुड ट्राई टू या एक्चुअली देयर सम नॉइज देयर. हेलो.
Sanjay, why don't you write it in the chat box? There is some noise from your background. So please write your question in the chat box. We'll definitely take it. There's some noise coming from Sanjay's background. So
Yes.
never
Yeah,
mind, Deepak,
let
if
me
you
answer.
understood the question, yeah, please answer this.
Yeah, actually. The answer is very simple. You are talking about the expression data. So expression data, when you try to go for the expression data, the actual distribution of any data is usually you can transform in the log values. Means you simply heard the term log fold change. So those log fold change is simply says that whether your expression is doubled or not. So in such cases, your data is definitely not following the normal distribution. And if your data is not following the normal distribution, whether you go for some non-parametric test, whether you, mostly in most of cases you go for the p value and you get the z value test. They perform z test in most of the these gene expression data. So basically, those z test is actually some sort of feature exact test, and it is a example of a non-parametric test. So when you try to see the expression of some unique gene in a different tissue in the same population, your data, your expression data is for non-normally distributed, and you go for the non-parametric test, which is called the Z test, feature test, and you go to the same p values, and based on those p values, you can see there is a significantly different, significantly highly expressed or lowerly expressed, मतलब upregulated or downregulated. I hope this will be helpful for you.
Is there
One
any other question? Yeah.
more question, Dr. Deepak. So you said that these tests depends upon the type of the data, raw data we have. How about if we have samples which, in which, for instance, let's say we have in one sample we have 10 values, in second sample we have 4 values, in third sample we have 20 values. So when the sample size is different, what are your recommendation to go about choosing an appropriate test?
As I already told, the parametric test you can use on a certain condition. First one is that your data should follow the normal distribution, and the another set thing is that it must be either numerical values. So when you say there is a number of samples are different, it is a counted data, okay? And suppose even though it is a counted one, suppose it is a numerical value. Suppose you are in some you find few genes which are expressed, and another sample very few genes are expressed. So in such scenario, you can see your number of samples are insufficient to identify the appropriate distribution of the data, because on a number on a 10 or 4 number of samples you have, even though it has some numerical value, you cannot confidently calculate its mean value and standard deviation. So in such scenario, when you have small number of samples, you usually go for the non-parametric test, usually the feature exact test. Even in a gene expression data, you mostly see if there is a number of samples are small, you usually go for the Z statistics, which is actually feature exact test. I hope it is now you can
how small is a small
Actually, there is no such rule of thumbs. Means how, but it says for calculating some appropriate or some confident value, you have at least 30 to 40 samples for each group. At least 30 to 40.
If there is any more question, please let us know. I request Sanjay to please switch off his mic. There is a lot of noise coming from there. So I hope Deepak, you have completed your presentation also. Is there anything left over there?
No, I think it's completed.
Yeah. So the main aim of getting Deepak and you for this particular topic is that because we wanted to start a sort of series for such webinars. Where we want to discuss about the data science, the data analysis, the data analytics, to be precise. And if the participants are actually interested in such webinars and seminars, we can keep a longer workshops where we can also include demonstrations of such tests using R or Python, a small workshop on Python. So if people are interested in, participants are actually interested in that, please let us know through our feedback page, or you can also write us an email or send us messages over LinkedIn or WhatsApp that if what exactly are you looking for in data analysis. So we'll be very happy to have Deepak again for such a session. And Deepak, it was really nice, insightful session. So there are actually two, I think, comments or questions from Sanjay and Rohit again. So Deepak, can you just check your chat box? So Sanjay is asking data coverage and parametric distribution, and Rohit is exactly presented in the hierarchy in which I learned. Okay, so Rohit is commenting, giving a comment. If students are interested, please let us know, please give your feedbacks. And if there are no more questions, I would like to thank Deepak for this wonderful presentation. I'm pretty much sure that everybody. So, Dr. Deepak, can you have a look at the chat box?
Actually, I see the question. So, data coverage in parametric distribution. Can you elaborate your question? Means in which sense you are asking?
You can just write it down, Sanjay, here.
सर मैं ये पूछ रहा हूँ, अगर कोई जब डाटा उसका एक मीडियन वैल्यू और स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन वैल्यू है, अगर 30 मीन वैल्यू है, 5 का डेविएशन है, तो वैल्यू हो गई 25 से 35, पर जो एक्सट्रीम, तो इसमें डाटा कवरेज कितना होगा, क्योंकि एवरेज, क्योंकि कुछ नंबर होंगे जो 35 से भी अबव है और जो 25 से बिलो भी है, क्योंकि वो डिपेंड सिग्निफिकेंस होता है, अगर हम किसी ड्रग का इफेक्ट करें बेस्ड ऑन कुछ वेट हाइट.
Yeah, that I already explained when I show you this graph. Let me share my screen one more time. Just wait a minute. Yes. यहाँ पे जैसे आप देख सकते हैं, दिस इज द मीन वैल्यू एंड दिस इज योर स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन. सो व्हेन आई थिंक समवन, कैन यू प्लीज, ओके थैंक्स. सो हियर यू कैन सी, दिस इज द इन आइडियल सिनेरियो ऑफ ए नॉर्मल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन. This is the mean value and this is the standard deviation. So this is the first standard deviation. So when it is a ideal normal distribution, the data lies between this point, u minus sigma to u plus sigma. It contains 66%, almost 66% of your data. So, and when you go for 2 sigma and 3 sigma, it gradually increases. Like at a 3 sigma level, you covered almost 99.8% of your total data. So when you go for the three standard deviation away,
you collect almost your 99.8% data in a normal normally distribution and in a normally distributed data. So this is your data coverage. So when you talked about this kind of data, you simply see, you can compare your min value, your maximum value, and also go for the quantile range estimation. So what is the quantile range estimation? In case of your normal distribution, your mean, median, and mode is the single value. So those 50%, your mean value actually represents your middle value of your data, and this middle value, when you talk about the location, it is called the median value. And this median value is your 50% quantile region. Means this is the clear line on left side, exactly 50% data samples are left side and 50% data on the right side. So when you put all together, then you can see when you have value of mean, you have value of median, you know the quantile region, you know the standard deviation, then on the basis of all those values, you can simply